And he said that, yes, it's difficult to set up a factory in Hong Kong, and we need government support, we need land supply, we need tax concessions. I think I will give more time for members to consider this. So I'd like to invoke 41 and ask for an adjournment of this debate. And this is according to Rule 41. And in relation to an issue being discussed in the council, the member may move without notice that the further proceedings of the committee be now adjourned. Well, in accordance with Rule 41 of the Rules of Procedure, I now put the question to you, that is in relation to the proposed resolution under Section 54A. Of the IGCO to be moved by the Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development in relation to these two resolutions, and also in relation to the amendments of Mr. Chen Qichun and Mr. Albert Chan, the related debate should now be adjourned. Under Rule 45 of the Rules of Procedure, it shall not be in order to move an amendment to a motion under the provision of this rule. Members may speak on the subject. Secretary, would you like to speak? Does any member wish to speak? Mr. Albert Chan, I am sorry. You have spoken. According to the Rules of Procedure, just now you spoke to move this motion to adjourn the debate. So your time has ended, but after other members have spoken, you still have one session. You still have one more round to go. Mr. Chen Qichun, I ask for a quorum call, please.
Wong Kwok-Heng 議員.
Mr. Wong Kwok-Heng, Chairman, I would like to say three things. First, I think Mr. Albert Chen's motion to adjourn the debate is in fact a filibustering tactics. Second, if they continue to move motions to adjourn the debate and to resort to call for quorums to filibuster, then they will not get any public support. Third, lest all object to this wrong motion to adjourn the debate. That's all I want to say. Dr. N. Chang. President, this is a motion moved by Albert Chen, and they are the same people calling for the debate. And they are exactly, and they are also the ones to call for adjournment of the debate. So it seems that they want to have all the say. They are changing their stance all the time. Is it the case that they have schizophrenia? So I speak to object to Mr. Albert Chen's motion to adjourn the debate. Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, I speak to oppose this motion to adjourn the debate. President, the arrangement for the debate originally is for the secretary to speak first, and then the two members who moved the amendments should speak, and then they will each speak for 50 minutes, totaling 30 minutes, and then it's my turn to speak as the chairman of the relevant subcommittee. I've been waited for so many hours for my chance to speak. Well, the two members should originally have been speaking for 30 minutes, but because there have been calls for quorum, and then more than two hours have elapsed, and now they are moving a motion to adjourn the debate. So what the public are seeing is that these members are standing in the way of Hong Kong's progress. We all support development of INT in Hong Kong, and they are now blocking us to do that. And establishment of ITB is a part of promoting INT, of course, is not the whole plan. We want to promote INT. We want better collaboration between the industry, the government, the academia, and the R&D sectors. And I think it's the community has forged a consensus to move forward, and I think they are repeatedly standing in the way of establishing the ITB, and some members are just opposing for the sake of opposition.
They want to discredit the government, they want to hinder progress in Hong Kong, and so I oppose this motion. President, Mr. Chen Qichun. Thank you, President, and I thank Mr. Albert Chen for moving this motion. Members can speak in support of the motion. They can choose to speak to oppose the motion. But then I hope that members can get their logic right. N. Chang said that we asked for the debate, and then we are now asking for an adjournment of the debate. Now, I think she is wrong. Now, in fact, I did not ask for the debate, but I did move some amendments. Now, in fact, there are many reasons for wishing to adjourn a debate that is going on. And I want to say that we are unhappy with the motion moved by the government. And of course, we have to seize every opportunity to make our views known. Now, please do not always say that we are filibustering. So don't think that whenever we speak, we are filibustering. And if all 27 pan Democrats speak, and as a result, we can't pass the motion today, so will you regard that as filibustering? Now, in fact, each member can only speak once. Each member can only speak for 15 minutes. So is this filibustering? And then concerning the call for a quorum count, as the president has advised members, if members or stay in this chamber and take part in the proceedings of the council, we cannot really block the progress that you want. We are the minority. We have only a few members, but you are in the majority. You have over 40 members. And so, Chairman, I want to say that I have to set the record straight. Please do not think that whenever members speak, they are filibustering. Please do not think that whenever members speak, they are blocking progress. They are wasting taxpayers' money. Now, in fact, when we oppose certain infrastructural projects, that's because we do not want taxpayers' money to go down the drains. And then concerning this IT bureau, some may say there's no harm in setting up this bureau. It won't cost taxpayers too much money. But we may only need several tens of millions of dollars a year to support the operation of the bureau. We may only need to spend a few million dollars a year to pay the secretary. But then we are worried that Hong Kong's interests will be harmed because this will become an opportunity for the government to hand out certain benefits to some parties. We are unhappy because the government has not really responded or addressed our concerns. In fact, I suggested that a team of officials led by the financial secretary should come to tell the council why the bureau should be set up. And now Mr. Greg So is here to tell us that a new bureau should be set up so that his workload can be reduced. And in fact, I've also said that we should carry out a value for money study on the work of the CEDB, especially with regard to communications and technology and also innovation. So in fact, I hope that for members who support the motion, they can tell me later in their speeches what the CEDB has intended to do to promote innovation and technology. Yes, I understand that certain funds have been set up and then parties have been held to celebrate certain so-called achievements. And then, of course, we've got a science park. But then, Mr. So, I believe you will not properly address my concerns. When I last spoke, I asked whether the bureau had met the key indicators, and then whether you didn't have enough time to promote innovation technology, whether you didn't have expertise, whether your boss did not give you adequate resources, and so on and so forth. Now, when I spoke last time, I said that in fact in Hong Kong we had talents in innovation and technology, but then the government did not really treasure such talents. The government starts to treasure them only when they worked very hard overseas and obtained awards. No, and when they've got awards, or when they got awards, the government held parties for them. And in fact, at the party, one of the award winners lamented how he was ignored by the FEHD or the CFS. So when that person was still working hard for his career, the government ignored him. But then when he got an award, the government would say, oh, at that time, I was trying to use such means to make you work hard. In fact, we in Hong Kong have very good inventions. In fact, for example, there are these small fish which can test whether there is any poison in the water. So I think, in fact, let's just use the money that is supposed or that is for paying the secretary to send these talents to international competitions. I'm sure they will win awards, and then CY Leung will boast of Hong Kong's achievements and the government's support for them. So this is how innovation and technology develops or has been developing in Hong Kong. And I think the paper given to the council on the proposed setting up of the bureau lacked substance. That's why I think we should pass this motion to adjourn the discussion. In fact, we in the panel raised many questions, but then the government gave only limited information, and the government seemed to suggest to us that that was all that it could tell us, and we could either take it or leave it. And I think Greg So knows very well that there will be enough votes to pass the motion. Some said that we were opposing for the sake of opposing. Of course, we will not be supporting for the sake of opposing. So the administration has never discussed other alternatives with us seriously. The government merely said that a particular option would not be efficient, another option would not be feasible. But then the government hasn't really told us what this new bureau intends to do. The vision, the mission, the objectives will all be laid down by the secretary. So if we are told now what the bureau intends to do, if we know what the objectives of the bureau are, then say 2 years or 3 years later, we can hold CY Leung accountable. We can tell him that in fact the bureau hasn't really met its objectives. And concerning the vision and the mission of this bureau, the government keeps talking about collaboration among the government, the industry, the academia, and so on and so forth. So, and then concerning the need to improve quality of life, the need to enhance productivity, I think even secondary school students know to say these. In fact, I once talked to Professor Ng, and at that time, the Secretary for Economic Development and Commerce was Mrs. Rita Lau, and the professor told me that, in fact, at a party, at a reception, it was difficult for the academia to of the academics to approach her and talk to her because she was always surrounded by businessmen. So I think we need to really look at why we have not done a good job here in Hong Kong to promote innovation and technology in the past. Mr. Chan, I want to know that, in fact, what you have just said should have been said in the debate on whether members support the secretary's two motions. But I think the same arguments can be used to support Mr. Chen's motion to adjourn the debate. I do not support Mr. Seoul's two motions, and that's why I support Mr. Albert Chen's motion, this present motion. And no, you know, in politics, one day is too long, and maybe next week, Sivai Leung may no longer be our CE. So, President, maybe you know that I will be talking about the perks enjoyed by Mr. Seoul. So, I will not talk about these. I don't want to really make you too angry. I want to say that the secretary has not studied the other options put forward by members seriously. Now, the Mr. Seoul may may have some exchanges of us on the proposed RTB when we meet him in the antechamber. But then the political assistant, the undersecretary, have never lobbied members for support. And in fact, the secretary hasn't lobbied us for support either. Only Mrs. Fanny Law said something to that effect. I think it's important that we have a level playing field in Hong Kong if we want to really promote innovation and technology. Government should not be standing in the way of the development of innovation and technology in Hong Kong. Now, the bureau hasn't been set up yet. And in the meantime, what are you doing in your bureau, Mr. Seoul? Is it that you have to wait till the baby is born and then you leave everything to the baby, to the new baby? And then when we ask questions, when we want to have another session of meeting, we are accused of filibustering. And as I said last time, in fact, we cannot block the handling of this motion. In fact, each member can only speak once, and the time limit is 15 minutes. And then we'll only can only spend 1 minute on voting on each of the CSAs. And so very soon we'll have to vote on this motion, or the secretary's two motions. I don't know whether Mr. Leung Kwok Hong will be attending our meeting today. I think I have to point out that the SAR government has never tried to encourage competition. In the Hong Kong TV licensing incident, we can see that the government likes to break the rules. We do not want to give the government more resources, more powers to transfer benefits and interests to certain parties. Some say that even if they really want to stand in the CE election, they may not want to take part in the election because CY Leung can continue to lobby the election committee members for support. And so if the EC can elect the CE, then there is no chance that another candidate can win. And so I think this motion should be moved by the next term of government.
And by then, Mr. Greg So can have a review, and this will help our discussion. Does any other member wish to speak? Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development, do you wish to speak? Mr. Albert Chen, you may now speak. Thank you, Mr. President. Now, Mr. President, you asked the Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development twice in this motion to adjourn the debate whether he wished to speak, and he said no. So this is really alarming with the 43-member strong pro-establishment camp here in this council. The administration doesn't have to speak. It is mute because it's under the protection of the pro-establishment camp. Can't he state his reasons as well? Can't he make a speech like Mr. Wong Kwok Hing stating the reasons, or is it because you do not have a script, you do not have speaking notes? If you don't, if you can't speak Chinese well, then you speak English. Since you've been living in Canada for so long, or be a Chinese and speak Putonghua. So it's really alarming to see how he has been silent on this subject to adjourn the motion debate. Nowhere in the world do we see that any government handling issues like this. We've never seen any government officials like this secretary dishing out business cards only after reunification. And that he could just take he could just enjoy his time and just make a few passing remarks. It's really alarming, because we're supposed to have debates here in this council. You should make known your stance. Well, even like what other members did, they at least spoke to and made their positions clear. But now we have this silent council. One must wonder what we have become and how far we have deteriorated, how far this council and the government have deteriorated. As a former chairman of DAB and as president of this council, you are one of the few political talents in Hong Kong, being a leftist, and I think you will find it really disheartening to see a government acting like this. And yesterday, Mr. Chen Qichun made a mistake about the location. He was mistaken about Shenzhen and Guangzhou, and then the pro-establishment camp immediately mocked him. And we acted in accordance with the procedure, and the government has proposed a resolution. And Dr. An Cheng, we just follow procedures, and this is the arrangement that it is time for us to debate on the resolution. So perhaps she should keep silence, as other members suggest. She should learn and understand what is going on. Well, just like Mr. Tamil Chong, when he was chairman of the subcommittee, he ruled that simply by saying your mother, it amounted to a foul language. Mr. President, in short, this is not the kind of language to be used in this council. But you shouldn't say that it is not foul language. You should say that it is not a remark acceptable by this council, and that he could direct the member to withdraw his comment. So you should coach him, Mr. President. Please don't digress, Mr. Albert Chen. And then Dr. Lo Wai Kwok just now made a wrong argument as well. Well, Dr. Lo Wai Kwok, we now already have a bureau in charge of innovation technology. This bureau, this existing bureau, is in charge of this policy area. Earlier, we approved $5 billion for the bureau to set up a fund and invite applications. Well, this member who's in strong support of this issue, who knows very well about this, could make such a remark, saying that we need to escalate the issue to the level of bureaus. Well, Mr. President, back then when we debated on the express rail link, and when we debated on the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, when we debated on the cruise terminal, you may recall that all the arguments, the logic, the attitude that they had was just the same as constitutional reform proposal, and that if we do not pocket it first, our local economy would be hampered, our competitiveness would be affected, and that cost would spiral. Well, I asked some very important questions. I asked Eva Chang, I said that the site investigation was done too hastily, and that there was something wrong with the design, and that the collaboration model with MTRCL should be handled very carefully in order to safeguard the proper use of public money. And then they just gave all the undertakings, saying that they would be careful. And in fact, as it turns out, the questions I asked 5 years ago were all valid. So similar to this establishment of the ITB, well, it was supposed to be set up 3 years ago. It was supposed to be done very hastily. In the end, because of filibustering, we managed to scrap it. And originally, it wasn't called the Innovation Technology Bureau. It was called Information and Technology Bureau. And then they just changed the title and start afresh, and still they haven't explained to us the details. Chairman, I need to drink some water. I asked for a quorum count.
Chen Wei Yu.
Mr. Albert Chen, thank you, President. The last point that I want to make is that some members said that my motion to adjourn the debate is considered as filibustering. I don't think that is the case. Well, a member may speak for 50 minutes at most, and at most the debate will last for 40 minutes, and the members choose not to be here to attend the meeting, and that's why we asked for quorum counts. We didn't originally intend to be a filibustering tactics, but that was actually what happened as a result. Say, if you are a football team and the players were not playing well enough properly, and they should be winning the match, but then some members of the team are so improper, they don't have the skills, and they are not vigilant enough, so the football team will lose the match. So, President, I call myself an opposition member. Our responsibility is to monitor the government, to point out the government's mistakes, to identify or highlight problems in maladministration. So on the subject of ITB, I have repeatedly pointed out that, Secretary, you haven't really thought through the proposal. It is just an idea from this CY Leung, and he said this when he was electioneering for the position of CE, and there wasn't any in-depth discussion internally. Well, for past major projects like the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, the building of the cruise terminal, the XRL, detailed studies were made. Well, even when that was done, there were still a lot of questions or problems pending. So that's why consultation is very important. We should discuss everything in the open, and then the government can give us all the proposals, and we try to gauge views from the community, the wisdom of everyone, including the professionals, the experts, and those who have been in the field, and through various studies and views collected from the veteran members and the average member of the public, then we can pull everyone's wisdom. As I said just now, I've talked to a veteran in the field, INT field. He was once a member of the advisory committee, and he is also in the trade himself. When I discussed the details with him, he said that there are still flaws and inadequacies in the proposal. He was the one who's supposed to convince me of establishing the ITB. When we talked further and further, he said that we should have research integrating with our production. You spent millions of dollars on the matter, and there was this study I found out that on the material of of a sportswear, how it is related to athletes' performance. Well, if we have a major factory in Hong Kong which can produce such materials, then we can go ahead with such studies. But then, if that is not the case, what's the point of carrying out such studies? What good does it do to people's livelihood? Do you do research just for the sake of doing research? If we are talking about spending public money, we should be prudent. CY Leung said that it has everything to do with Hong Kong's future. But what kind of research will you undertake? I've been suggesting or recommending five value-added industries, watches and clocks, jewelry, pharmaceuticals, environmental protection, and clothing. I'm not saying that these studies should be done in these five areas, but all I'm saying is that your research should be related to Hong Kong's manufacturing industry and Hong Kong's people's livelihood. The CY Leung, fans and cronies, I don't know what they are up to. Perhaps we will see another Barry Zheng, another Po Chan, another Eddie Ng being put into the position. The question now lies in that among the CY Leung fans, very often a person who is not familiar to us gets appointed to a certain position. Before CY Leung assumed office, he said that he would deal with housing issues. But since he assumed office, in the 2 years after he assumed office, the property prices have risen to an unprecedented high. He claimed that he would try to suppress property prices, but in effect, such results are nowhere to be seen. And on the contrary, the property prices have skyrocketed. That will happen also to the IT sector, I believe. I think CY Leung is a liar, and the whole government is like a mental hospital, and we've got a new patient here. The secretary here, he has problems in speaking. He's like a dumb person, and he's been telling lie after lie after lie. Should we pocket it first? Will it deteriorate to become another XRL project? Another NENT development project? Obviously, the NENT development project is for the benefit of the conglomerates, for the Po Chan. He's been hoarding land and pocketed tens of millions of dollars out of this. So the government's decisions are skewed towards the rich who can profiteer, and he would appoint somebody to be in a senior position, and then the person will be including some overseas conglomerates and pocketing profits and so on. Well, your time's up. Two other members would like to speak, Mr. Chung Kwok Pan and Chan Kim Po. But actually, I have asked whether any other members wish to speak before I asked Mr. Albert Chan to have a response. And he was the one who moved this motion. In our arrangement for debates, after the member who moved the motion had the final word, then the debate would come to an end. So I would now put the question to you, and that is that in relation to the motion moved by the Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development, and also the motions amendments moved by Mr. Raymond Chan, Mr. Albert Chan, and that debate be adjourned. Will those in favor please raise their hands? Mr. Chan claims division. The bell will ring for 5 minutes.
I
would like to remind members that we will be voting on Mr. Albert Chen's motion to adjourn the debate. If the motion is passed, then the debate that has been going on will be adjourned, and we will move on to other business on the agenda. Voting begins. Members, please check your votes. If there are no queries, voting is closed. The results are displayed. Members from FCs, 20 present, 1 yes, 19 no's. Members from GCs, 21 present, 4 yes, 13 no's. The question is not agreed by a majority of each of the two groups of members present. I declare the motion negatived. So this council will continue to join.